All these pieces broken and scattered in the sea. Empty hands, I'm not You take our pain, you take our weakness, you set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, and be your answer.
As sweet as that, that saved a wretch like me. Welcome to worship today. Welcome to the folks at home. Glad that you're here with us as well. I understand we're having some more sound issues, so...
No?
No, you got it? You figured it out? Scratch that. They figured it out. So hopefully, folks at home, you'll be able to hear us just fine. That's good news. Today is Don and Millie's Day, so if you go to the Don and Millie's over here, you know the drill, at 84th and O, tell them you're from St. Andrews. and 20% of your ticket comes back to the youth group. So it works out that every year or so, we earn enough money to send somebody to the youth gathering. So we get a fair amount of money from that fundraiser. So thank you so much for your support of the youth in that way. Plus, it's good food, right? Yeah, it's good food. We're doing the Faith Forum today. Today is Tech 101, so if you need some help in figuring out how to access St. Andrews online, this is for you. We are going to be in the atrium. Oh, I forgot to get all that stuff out. I'll have to get that stuff out. Meet me in the atrium, and we'll get started just as soon as my computer is available. Ken has to convert the Zoom video and do some things before he can shut it down. So it'll be just a few minutes to do that, and then we can get started in there. And we have treats. We have treats. I don't know what they are, but I know we have treats. Annette Henry made special treats for us. And then don't forget, too, that we have midweek worship for Lent now. And it's interesting, this is the first time that I remember all the Wednesdays of Lent land in the same month. There's five Wednesdays in March, and they all land in March. So by the time we get to April, we're into Holy Week, and then Easter is on the 9th. So there you go. So Wednesdays in March, I expect you here. Right? No excuses. We're other than ice. That's right. We're going to be learning about the sassy saints. There were a number of saints that landed in the month of March. They're feast days or festival days or whatever. And so three of them are honest to goodness saints. They've been beatified and canonized by the church. And the other two are just people that you need to know about, like Harriet Tubman and Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Or two folks that you need to know about. The other ones are honest-to-goodness saints. So it'll be fun to learn about them. Our theme for Lent is seeking. If you watched on Wednesday night, we played a game, and somebody actually guessed that's what I'm doing up here. So we've got things that we use to seek. We've got a telescope. We've got binoculars, microscope, cell phone for Googling, magnifying glass. I've got my Lucy ornament up here. She's on the phone asking Ricky for a favor. It talks. It's really fun. We've got the wise men, Bible, prayer, and a snitch from Harry Potter. Because what position did Harry Potter play? He was the seeker. That's right. He's the seeker on Quidditch. So, if you do not know Harry Potter lore, you need to learn. Read the book. Watch the movie. Read the book first. And then watch the movie. Please stand as you're able, and we will begin with our call to worship. Listen, there is hope to be found here. Listen, God calls you by name. Listen, there is love that abides here. This world is full of chatter, so we may do our best to listen.
God is speaking.
Let us worship.
Amen.
Friends, if you are seeking grace, this moment is for you. If you are seeking growth, this moment is for you. If you are seeking honesty, this moment is for you. In the prayer of confession, we admit to ourselves and to God that we do not have it all figured out. And in that vulnerability, we are surrounded by God's grace. So let us pray together. Holy God, too often we treat your word like a radio station, something we can tune in and out of whenever it's convenient. Our minds are full of ads, emails, news updates, and notifications. In the midst of this clutter, we tend to gravitate toward the voices that think like us, easily ignoring the voices being silenced. Easily ignoring your voice. Forgive us for failing to listen. Forgive us for getting caught in distractions. Forgive us for getting what your voice is. Drain the distractions from our minds and help us turn once again toward you. With earnest hearts we pray. Amen. Friends, even when we tune God out, even when we prioritize other voices, even when we do all the talking and fail to listen, we are still held by God. Our sins are forgiven. Nothing could ever separate us from God's love. So with joy in our hearts, please repeat after me. I am loved.
I am loved.
I am held in grace.
I am held in grace.
I belong to God.
I belong to God.
Amen.
Amen.
And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sorrow, still we are the voice in the desert crying, preparing the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Servant David rebuilding a temple of praise, and these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as white in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold,
Jehovah, there's no God like 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 Jehovah.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Have mercy.
Shuffle into this space and try to quiet our minds, but the list of distractions is long. We need your help to listen. So today we ask that you would marinate us in your word, dust the cobwebs from our ears, stir our souls awake, crack open our hearts to make room for you, scoop us up, put us in your pocket. Carry us with you wherever you go. We want to hear you, really hear you. So speak to us now. With hope we pray. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please greet one another with the word of God's peace.
The first reading for this morning is from Genesis chapter 2. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but the tree of knowledge of good and evil you should not eat, for in that day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree of the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, We shall eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsive with me, Psalm 32. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered.
Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit.
While I kept silence, my body wasted away, through my groaning all day. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer.
Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you at a time of distress. The rush of mighty water shall not reach them.
You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you.
Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you.
Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart.
We are turning, Lord, to hear you. You are merciful and kind, slow to anger, rich in blessing, and with love to us inclined.
The Holy Gospel for this first Sunday of Lent is from the fourth chapter of Matthew. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. And I'd like to invite the kids to come up for children's time. Good morning. How is everybody today?
Good.
Good? All right. I want to talk to you this morning about this word that I have. Do you know what this word says? That's an A, that's right. An L.
Where's an H?
There's no H. There's A's and L's and E's, or one E. And a U. Mm-hmm. Do you know what this word is?
A.
Yeah. You see the A's? Yeah. There are two A's, you're right. This word is alleluia. Can you say that?
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Yeah, alleluia. That's a U, that's right. And one of the things we do as a church, as a congregation, is we don't say this word during Lent. You, yep. Uh-huh. And an A, that's right. So we put away the alleluias during Lent, because Lent is a serious time. And it's not a time. No, it's not. It's not backwards. Trust me, it's not. So we're going to put the alleluias away this morning. Where'd my box go? Oh, there it is. So we're not going to say alleluia for 6 weeks until it's time for Easter. Okay?
Easter?
Yep. We've got 6 weeks till Easter. So I'm going to fold this up. Okay, and we're going to get my box over here. Let's get my box. Okay. And we're going to put the alleluias in the box. Okay. Yeah. And then we're going to put it up there at the altar. You want to come with me to put it away?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. Let's go. I need a little more room to get up. There we go. Okay. Nope, don't touch that stuff. Don't touch that stuff. It's fragile. Okay. So, we're going to put it right under here. Okay? We're going to put it under there. So, we're going to bury the alleluias under the quilt. Okay, just the alleluias, not you guys. Okay, Victoria, come out, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So, on Easter Sunday, we'll pull those out again. And that's when we'll get to praise the Lord again and say alleluia, right? But until then, that's the last time I'm going to say it. I'm not going to, Victoria, please put that down. Victoria?
Hola.
See?
Olila. Ololo.
Okay, this is for looking at, not for touching. Okay, let's go back over here. Nope, we're not saying it anymore, Henry, remember? We're done. Yeah, we're done. Okay. Yep. Okay, so. Okay, you ready to have our prayer? So we're going to fold our hands and we're going to bow our heads and you're going to repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for being with us. Help us to love others. And we look forward to Easter when we can say that special word again. Amen. Good job. Hey, thanks for coming up today. I'm glad I'm not the only one they fight over. Oh, wrong way! Almost lost one. So as I was saying before, our theme this year for Lent is about seeking. And we're asking questions to lead us into deeper faith. So on Wednesday night, if you were not able to join us because of the ice storm, or maybe you joined us online but you couldn't hear. Yeah, that was a big problem on Wednesday. So I asked the question, what do you seek? Or who do you seek this Lent? And I've got questions that are back there on the window. Each week there's going to be a new question as we work our way through Lent and we're kind of move our way across. So stop by after worship. And there's some sticky notes and some markers. I checked the markers this morning. I didn't know half of them were dead. Sorry about that. But the ones that are in there now work. And so you can write down your responses. What are you seeking this Lent? And just stick it to the window, or if you've got, those sticky notes are kind of old, so they may not have a lot of stick. I've got some tape in there too, just in case. So you can put that up. But today, the question is, who or what influences you? What do you listen to, or who do you listen to? So that's also up there as well. Dr. David Loos, who was a former professor at Luther Seminary, he was a preaching professor. He was also the former president of Philadelphia Seminary before it joined with Gettysburg and became Union Seminary. He's now serving a large congregation in Minneapolis. Anyway, about 15 years ago, he did some research on influencing. And he said that on average, we receive over 40,000 messages every day. And who knows what it is now. If you're on your phone all day long, it's probably more. And yet, if you're unplugged, you don't have a computer, you don't have a smartphone, it's probably less. But remember, the number one rule of marketing is to make us feel bad. The number one rule is to make us feel discontented, that we are not good enough, just with who we are and what we have. And we will be so much better off if we buy the latest and greatest whatever it is, right? And in some ways, that is the serpent's strategy in the temptation story in Genesis, where the serpent says to Eve, "Are you unhappy with your lot in life in paradise? You want to be like God? Let me show you how." And the problem is, as you know, the problem is that Adam and Eve already were like God, in every way that mattered, anyway. They were the pinnacle of God's creation, and God was the proudest of the human beings. God made them in God's own image, and so Adam and Eve couldn't be any more like God if they tried, except for perhaps having the knowledge of good and evil. I love this story, but I despise the way that it is used against women. Eve gets a bad rap here, as if sin being in the world is all her fault, just hers alone, and therefore this passage is used to make women seen as being less than men and being blamed for all the problems that we have. Now, as I read it, and hopefully as you read it, you've been around me long enough, hopefully you know how to read it this way. Adam and Eve were a package deal. They were there together, in and out and through everything. So you cannot tell me that Eve was the only one who was told, no, no, do not touch that tree. Adam knew as well. And if he were not just as tempted as she was, surely he would have said to her, Eve, this is really not a good idea. Remember what the Lord God said. But if that conversation took place, it's not recorded, because that's not the point of the story. The point of the story is not about assigning blame. The point of the story is that the first people listened to the serpent. They did not listen to God. They were not content to let God be God, but instead they wanted to be God themselves. And thus they sinned. They hid, they blamed God for what happened, they lied about what they did, and then they were banished. There were steep consequences for them because they chose not to listen to God. Hence our question, who do we listen to? Influencers are a big deal these days. If you do, I did a quick Google search on influencers, and the list was incredibly long. There were folks like Kim Kardashian and Beyonce, Taylor Swift and LeBron James, just to name a few. There's also this thing called the Oprah effect. Have you heard of this? That if Oprah says something is a good thing, or if a candidate is a good thing and she puts her weight behind them, either the product sells, the book sells, or the candidate wins. And if she says, no, I don't like this, then it tanks. It is a thing that they call the Oprah effect. Talk about having influence. We are surrounded by messages just like that, all day long, every single day. And I suppose the good news is, for us, is that Jesus was surrounded by temptation too. And he faced it. It would have been very easy for him to listen to the evil one. Because as the devil comes to him and he presents him with these arguments and these temptations, they seem pretty slick. They seem, on the surface, like there's nothing wrong with them at all. Plus, the evil one also questions Christ's very identity, the very core of who he is. If you are the Son of God. And remember, the story that happens right before this is the story of Christ's baptism. So if Jesus, we don't know what happened between Jesus being 12 and 30-ish. We don't know. Those 18 years are not recorded. They're not important. They're not important to the overall story that the gospel writers are trying to tell. But that being said, we don't know what kind of discernment happened between 12 and 30. We don't know how much Jesus understood about who he was and who and what God was calling him to be. But if he wasn't sure, if he had doubts that God was calling him to be, well, that God had, what, that he was his son and that God was calling him to be the Savior of the world, all of those doubts should have been squelched in his baptism. Because remember, the heavens are torn, he sees the dove, he hears the voice who says, "You are my beloved son. With you I am well pleased." So immediately, as soon as he comes up out of the water, Jesus is taken, driven, led into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. And it's no doubt to me that the evil one had a front row seat to all of this. The evil one was watching all of this very, very carefully, waiting for an opportune time to come in and get him. And perhaps this is why he chooses to strike there first. If you are who you say you are, then prove it. Turn these stones into bread. Well, that seems simple, right? If Jesus is the Son of God, we know what he's capable of. We know these stories. Snapping his finger would have been so easy. He could have done that and turned those stones into bread. He had been out there in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. He probably only had with him a little bit of water just to sustain himself. I can only imagine how hungry he was. I get hungry after 40 minutes. I cannot imagine 40 days. So he's physically weak. He's vulnerable. This is a great time for the devil to come and get him. But what often happens with fasting is while we might feel physically weak, the spiritual acuity is great. So if there was ever a time for Jesus to be on his game, it was now. and he can see right through these temptations, although they're sure that it sounded amazing to him to have some bread. But the problem is that if Jesus had chosen to give in to this temptation, if Jesus had chosen to turn those stones into bread, he would have been denying his humanity. Ordinary folk like you and me, we can't do that. We cannot look at a stone and say, turn into bread. We can't do it. So Jesus didn't do it either. And he chose instead to rely on God's help, just as we are supposed to do. Well, the next attempt for the evil one to get Jesus to forget who he is he takes him up to this very high mountain, and he says, if you are who you say you are, throw yourself down. Now, Jesus has already used scripture, because he says, as it was written. So now the devil is playing tit for tat. So the devil can use scripture too, and make it sound like God is on board with what he's trying to get him to do. And he says, it is written, the angels will save you so that your feet won't even touch a stone. Because God has this cosmic plan to save the world, right? Jesus has overcome so many hurdles so far, including being born in a barn. Not exactly the most sanitary place in the world. He survived infanticide that was ordered by Herod the Great. He even survived walking away from his parents at the age of 12, which, you know, if I had done that, I would not have seen the next day. But he survived that too, and more. Surely God is not going to throw in the towel on him now. And so the devil's saying, do it, Jesus. Do it. Do it. Make God prove to you just how much he loves you as his only son. Slick, right? But Jesus did not fall for this one either. He fought scripture with scripture, and he quotes Deuteronomy 6:16. Because again, ordinary folk like you and me, we have to live within certain laws. The most significant of those laws is gravity. And so if we jump off of something that's really tall, we're going to fall down. We're going to hurt ourselves. We might even die. None of that ends well. And maybe that's what the evil one was after. But Jesus saw right through that one too. And he chose not to use his power to keep himself safe and secure, but he chose instead to listen to God and trust that God would provide for him. The third temptation is my favorite of the three, because I think it is the most clever. It's the cleverest of these lies. The evil one is starting to sound like Monty Hall or Wayne Brady, and he's trying to make this deal with Jesus. And he takes Jesus to this high mountain, and he shows him all the kingdoms of the world. And all of this is mine, he says. No, it's not. No, it's not. Not at all. But it sure sounds good, right? All of this is mine. And I can give it to you for the small, tiny price of worshiping me. In other words, Jesus, if you will deny yourself as the Christ, I will give you a get out of the cross for free card. I will save you a lot of headaches from your dumb disciples who will not understand anything you say. I will save you from suffering, and all I require is this one tiny little thing. Worship me. Sell me your soul. Slick, right? But Jesus sees right through that too. He saw through the lies, and he told the evil one to leave. I'm sure that was cleaned up. Told him to get the heck out of there. Enough already. I will worship and serve only the Lord God. That's the Deuteronomy 6. And the evil one finally left him alone, and the angel showed up to help. What's so brilliant about this story is that we all face things like this. We all face temptations in one way or the other. And it is very tempting to take the easy way out sometimes. It is very easy to take out or to take the easy way out and buy into materialism and affluenza and consumerism and the cultural pressure that is all around us all the time. As I've said before, our entire economy is built on such things. The latest and greatest, whatever it is, we have to have it, even though what we have is just fine. It's tempting to feel unsafe, to take such things into our own hands, and we lock ourselves in behind closed doors and inside gated communities to protect ourselves from those people, whoever they are. And of course, it's good to make smart choices. Of course it is. Of course it is. I'm not saying leave your door unlocked at night or anything like that. But more importantly, we are to trust God to not lead us into unsafe situations. And perhaps the most seductive of all is power. Power is an incredible tempter. We all want to feel powerful. We all want to feel in control. But we are not invincible. And God wants us to love and worship only God, not our possessions, not our influence, and most certainly not our power. The good news for us today is that while the evil one may be powerful, tricky, and smooth, but his power is limited. And just because we love Jesus does not mean that we will not be tempted. Far from it. You and I have been marked with the cross of Christ. We have been sealed by the Holy Spirit in our baptism, which perhaps makes us even more of a target. Jesus certainly was. But the question before us today is, who do we listen to? Because there's lots of voices out there, lots of influencers who would have us turn this way or that way. But Scripture clearly tells us that the evil one will not win the day, the hour, or the moment. When we listen to Christ Jesus our Lord and allow ourselves to be influenced by him and him alone. Amen.
With me, walk with me.
When
as you are able. We are God's people by baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. In a world full of noise, we believe that God is speaking. In a world full of chaos, we believe that God is singing. In a world full of temptation, we believe that God is healing. Church, who will you listen to? We will listen to God, our creator, friend, and guide. Church, what will you listen for? We will listen for water in the desert, for the wind of the Spirit, for the laughter of children, for the sound of open doors, and for God's voice who calls us beloved. Amen. Please be seated. Let us join our hearts and our minds together in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this day. We thank you, Lord, for being the voice in our heads, for being the one whom we can listen to. Please be the one whom we do listen to. Thank you for calling us beloved, for reminding us that you have called us and claimed us and named us your own in our baptism. We are your beloved children, and we long to hear your voice. Speak to us, Lord God, and drown out all the rest of the noise that is in our head and all the rest of the noise that may be around us. Speak clearly. Help us to love you and one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church throughout the world. We ask a special blessing on every faithful heart who gathers in your name. Bless our bishops, Elizabeth Eaton and Scott Johnson. Bless all leaders in the church, especially in this holy time of Lent, as they lead us into a deeper relationship with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your beloved planet that you have given to us to enjoy and to steward and to take care of. Help us to walk lightly upon the earth, O God. Thank you for seeing us through the ice storm, and thank you for the promise of spring. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the nations of the world, particularly places that are living with violence or fear or injustice. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for the people of Russia. We pray for people who are living with drought in Africa. And we give you thanks for nations that are at peace. We pray, Lord, that you would let your Spirit dwell among all of us, whether we are in conflict or living at peace. Send your Spirit to all of us, either to lead us to peace or to lead others to peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our nation. We pray for the deep divisions in our country, that you would heal those as we look to you. Bless those who suffer this day as they recover from earthquakes or tornadoes or hurricanes or floods. Bless those who come to help, and may their resources be abundant. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick and the sad and the lonely. We pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those who are dying. We pray for those who do not know you, that they would come to know of your mercy and your grace. Hear now the names we lift before you who are in special need of your loving care, whether we speak those names out loud or from within our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, Lord God, for the ways that you use us, for the ways that you move in, through, and among us. Whether we're collecting items for Clinic with a Heart or preparing to support the autism walk, or maybe we are offering hospitality to a group who needs a safe place to meet. Thank you for the ways that you use us. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to use us. Help us to be a beacon of hope and light in our Meadow Lane neighborhood, in our city, and beyond. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting that you hear us and you will answer us as we lift these prayers to you in the mighty and amazing name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able.
ye people, come and praise the Most High. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Most High. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Most High. Come now and worship the Lord. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Savior. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Savior. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Savior. Come now and worship the Lord. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Spirit. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Spirit. Come, all ye people, come and praise the Spirit. Come now and worship the Lord.
On the night before he died, our Lord Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave it to them all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is God's table, and everyone is welcome here. So come, you who have great faith, and you who wish you had more. Come, you who've been here often, and you who've not been for a long time. Come, you who've tried to follow, and you who have fallen short. Come, not because I invite you, but because God desires to meet you here. And for those who are celebrating at home, please know you are part of this table and part of this meal. This is the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. The congregation may be seated.
Oh, Lamb of God, you bear the sin of all the world's away. Suffered death, our lives to save. Have mercy now, we pray. Oh, Lamb of God, you bear the sin of all the world away. You set us free from guilt and grave. Have mercy now, we your peace, we pray. When peace like a river attendeth my way, where sorrows like sea
with my soul,
with my soul.
you are able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ give us strength for today and hope for tomorrow. Amen. Amen. Embodied God, at your table we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and touch the world with your love. Amen. Amen. As you leave this place, may God bless you with seeking. Seek out the hungry. Seek the weary. Seek the good in every person you pass. Seek out the hopeful. Seek the faithful. Seek God in each of us. As you seek and as you wonder, may you find what you're looking for. In the name of our loving God, who is always seeking us, go now in peace. Amen. Amen.
Days you prayed and kept the fast, inspire repentance for our sin and free us from our past. You strove with Satan and you won. Your faithfulness and skill and trust in God's eternal word. Oh, parched and hungry, yet you pray and fixed your mind above. So teach us to deny ourselves that we may know God's love. Be with us through this season, Lord, and all our earthly days, that when the final Easter dawns, we join in heaven's praise.
As we begin these 40 days of Lent, we trust the Lord to lead us.
God's grace goes before us. Of whom shall we be afraid?
May the Lord bless these days and lead us into deeper fellowship with God and one another.
We give you thanks and praise, O God, for the journey that has yet to unfold before us.
Go in peace. Trust that God is with you.
We go with hope, reaching out, sharing grace. Thanks be to God.
God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways, and step by step you'll lead me. You are